I want to read you this quote. So this is from a number of articles. They keep saying this kind of stuff, you know, in one formulation or another. So this is the quote: COVID-19 pandemic has transformed our understanding of what is possible in terms of collective response to a global challenge. And that's what the Great Recess is about.
Successful or unsuccessful collective response?
They are assuming successful, of course, right? And I think they're having successful in the sense that what they've discovered, and I'm curious to see what you think about this, what they've discovered is that we'll go along with pretty much anything. That they can shut us down in our homes, lock us down, close everything, keep us from work, and we just roll over. I think that's what they've discovered.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like what they're saying, though. I mean,
not in those terms, right? What they're saying is we discovered that we can take collective action, lock everybody up, and everybody goes with it.
Oh, I see. I see what you're saying. Okay. Because I was just, to me, it was sort of obvious how bad the collective action was. And let me just say something about the conspiracy thing, because I think this is a complete dodge. So as you're saying, these are like the Great Reset is advocated by these very influential people. So what would it mean to say it's a conspiracy? The only thing that you could say is that it's you'd be exaggerating how influential it has been thus far. But the essential idea I would describe as global fascism. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what it is. And so, I mean, it's basically a bunch of people who are saying we should have global fascism. They're in a very influential position. And then people who are sort of on their side are saying, oh no, it's a conspiracy. They haven't been that influential yet. But it's like, no, we're trying to stop them from being influential. So just it's a total non-position to call it a conspiracy theory. And so what's interesting is, okay, you have this like campaign for global fascism. And sometimes I think of it as global pseudoscientific fascism. And part of the problem is that the whole capitalism side is characterized as anti-scientific, whereas capitalism makes science possible and is based on the science of, you know, human nature and what production and flourishing require. But there's this whole false alternative between like pseudoscientific global fascism and then supposedly unscientific global capitalism. But like, if you look at the pandemic, you just look at what's the most optimistic thing that's happened is the development of a vaccine. Can anyone really say that this is maybe they're saying this, but it just seems obvious that the lack of vaccine, the lack of PPE, just all of this is clearly a lack of capitalism. I mean, that's just the way it, so you could say there are things people can say that you've addressed and that Ankar has addressed in his article. Like there are things about, oh, well, capitalism has no means of dealing with people who are demonstrably dangerous spreading infectious diseases. And then we'll say, well, no, that's not true. If you can define something as a rights violation, the government can get involved. But just in terms of the freedom to come up with cures, that is a total failure of the pseudoscientific fascist establishment, that there were all these things, all this sand in the gears and all this prevention of stuff. And the thing anyone would have to give Trump credit for, if they gave him credit for anything, he doesn't deserve credit for much with this thing, is like, okay, he got some bureaucratic stuff out of the way. So there's just a theme here where like the fascism and government, like central government dictation of things, is clearly causing massive problems. Capitalism is clearly causing massive good things. And yet the solution is let's completely get rid of capitalism and give people complete control.
Yes. And they of course are taking credit for the vaccines. They're taking credit through, and again, while the Trump administration did take away some barriers, most of them are still in place, and we still don't have, for example, home testing for a buck a piece and stuff like that, which was scientifically available, but not approved. But then there's the whole warp speed thing. So they take it as all of this, the whole vaccine thing, is a proof that you could have public-private partnerships to get stuff done, because they view all of it as public-private, right? So the government funded these vaccines. You know, the one in Europe is out of Oxford University, and it was funded by the British government. It was funded by the U.S. government. The U.S. government has spent hundreds of billions of dollars on upfront buying the vaccines so that these companies can develop it. So, and generally, you're right in identifying this as fascism. It's not typically socialism. What these people are advocating is not directly the state ownership of the means of production. So they're not advocating, for example, that all these, like Pfizer, become a government company. What they're advocating for strongly is, oh yeah, we want corporations, but we want to completely control them. We want government, private, public partnerships, which is just fascism, which is just means government control over the means of production. So they really are fascist, and they view the vaccines as an example of the success of fascism.
And what about so that makes a little sense to me, but so what about the like lack of PPE or the lack of testing? Is anyone really arguing that if we weren't a lot freer, we wouldn't have, like, it would be a lot easier to produce PPE and it'd be a lot easier to produce? I mean, the government is just pointing a gun at us and saying you cannot do home testing.
But of course they're arguing this, right? Because they say, you know, if only we'd had better central planning, if only we'd had a COVID czar from day one, then he would have immediately, just like in World War II, and you know, the statists love to use World War II as an example. You know, we would have taken over GM. We would have stopped building those evil cars. We would have taken, I mean, I'm just making this up, right? But they would have taken over a factory and we would have forced them to make PPE, and we would have used the managerial ability of GM, right? We admire the managerial ability of GM. But what we need is a central planner to allocate in the common good or in the public interest, how resources need to be deployed. And if only we'd done that at the beginning of the thing, there would have been plenty of PPE, right? Just like there were plenty of tanks in World War II, right? We did that in World War II and we got lots of tanks by using this methodology. So, you know, they're mildly sophisticated. They're not, you can pretend that there's something there.
Right. Well, okay. So it's interesting because, you know, you've been in more of this. I know a lot about the climate part of this, which I know we'll jump to in a second. But I've thought since the beginning of this that pro-freedom people really need to make clear that this is a failure of the anti-freedom.
Absolutely.
Side in a whole, and that, and partially that means explaining what Ankar talked about, like a pro-freedom approach to infectious disease, like that kind of thing, but also just how, if only we had health capitalism, like all these issues of like all these things that don't apply to any other field, like, oh, shortages of capacity. How the hell are you talking about shortages of hospital capacity 9 months into something that everybody cares about?
As I pointed out on shows, you know, the whole, even the idea that hospitals don't have emergency capacity is all a product of government, because it has to be approved by, every time they expand by one bed, they have to get an approval of the government. That, you know, that everything about this crisis, and I think I've done some shows where I've described how a capitalist economy would respond. It's complicated because who knows how a capitalist, all we know is that it would respond, and would respond 1,000 times more efficiently. You can imagine the role of health insurance companies would have in a truly free healthcare system. You can imagine what hospitals would do and how clinics and how doctors would respond, how they're pharmaceutical. But of course, then in a real emergency, they would respond like 100 times better than what we can imagine, and in ways we can't even imagine. That's the beauty of markets.
Yeah, I mean, there are just these obvious, almost Soviet-style failures that, you know, we just know, even with a less regulated part of the mixed economy, that we wouldn't even expect.
But nobody is making that argument. So I make the argument, you know, John Cochrane, the economist, makes it once in a while. I don't see a lot of kind of the libertarian economists really engaged in these issues, unfortunately. Maybe I'm missing it, we saw the same, if you remember, we saw the same thing during the financial crisis, right? We were like, no, this isn't government, this isn't a market failure. And it was like nobody else speaking about this. Even the free market economists were for a long time quite silent about the causes of the financial crisis and who dominated. The statists dominated, you know, the story. And to this day, everybody thinks capitalism failed.
So one final point about this in terms of persuasion, as I have a term I'd like to use called arguing to 100, which basically means that you, like, 100 is the ideal or the goal that everyone is agreeing to. And so, like, in there's, you know, the goal of equality, and then the evil negative 100 is inequality. And like, you don't want to play that game. You don't want to agree, oh, equality is 100. And then sort of start arguing, oh, this policy doesn't decrease equality as much as you think, or that kind of thing. And so with you know, part of the great title, Capitalism, the Unknown Ideal, is the idea that like a capitalist society is an ideal. And part of that is always having an exciting vision of what that looks like. And then also looking at the existing society and look at, oh, look at how the capitalist elements are making possible all of these amazing things. And I think sometimes when people feel like the dominant thing is against them, so the dominant thing is anti-capitalism, then they think the solution is just to react to the individual charges. But it's actually much more powerful if you have your own positive ideal and you say, like, this is what we're actually for. This is what we need to move toward. And then this evil is going against that. And that's I think, a lot of the free market people are very reactive versus having a vision of a positive world. Without that vision and without clear positive policies to get there, you can, I mean, you can just sort of move backwards more slowly.
Yeah, and you can't inspire, you know, particularly young people want idealism. They want a vision. They want something they can fight for. And the socialists, you know, the socialists keep altering their vision. So, you know, now they have a whole story about worker-owned factories and how wonderful it would be. So they keep, every time something fails, they alter their vision and they have but they always have an ideal. They always project some form of utopia out there that people can get excited about. And mm-hmm. I agree with you completely. Outside, other than, you know, than Rand on, you know, in Gold Gulch, obviously, there's the ideal, has not really done that and never does that. You know, I've talked about the fact that the left, for example, on healthcare, the left has always said, we know what we want. And they've said this publicly. We want 100% socialized healthcare. For 100 years, they've said this, right? You can go back to the 30s and you can find this. We can't get it all at once. So we're just going to chip away and we're going to keep compromising in that direction. But that's where we want to go. We all know that. We all acknowledge. Right? So everybody's to the left of Bernie Sanders in terms of their ideal. They're just compromising on how to get there. The right has never said what we want is 100% health, private health care. And look what a beautiful, here's how it would work and here it goes.
Right.
They've always said, we don't want that. We don't want what the left has, but we want a little bit, a little bit. And every time the left wins, the right embraces that program, Medicare,
right.
Whatever, and then just fights a rear guard action constantly. And there's no vision. There's nothing to strive towards. So you have to lose when you don't have a vision.
Yeah, and it must be a lot just because morally the ideal is collectivist. So like, how are you going to have, if your ideal is collectivist, the way it works is, okay, the people trying to set the policies to get to the ideal, which means government control of it. Well, it's just, oh, human nature isn't good enough mm-hmm. for that. It's not good enough. And so then what ends up happening is it becomes these appeals to imminent disaster. So it's just, oh, if Medicare gets passed, like let's say in the 60s, like no healthcare is going to work and everything is going to be totally dysfunctional. And then guess what? The world doesn't end. Yep. And so then they embrace it and say, well, of course, Medicare, who would challenge that, iconic American institution, but no, we don't want this prescription drug thing or whatever. But it's always like, yeah, we accept where we are in the progression. And then we kind of make this overblown claim that literally the world is going to end with the next regulation. Versus no, like we could have a much better world where we would have so much of an opportunity to be healthier and there would be all these cures that are discovered. I mean, just think about examples. I'm sure you know people like this. I have people very close to me like this where, you know, a sibling or a mother or a father dies of something that then is completely curable 10 years later.
Yep.
And you just think about what is like, and I just always think those bastards, those statists, like, we would have definitely had this cure. Absolutely. Had it not been for them restricting freedom. But that's part of the perspective of having like an ideal of, oh, this is what would happen if we had health freedom.
And you're right. The ideal is rooted, has to be rooted in a moral vision. And the problem is that 90% of people on the right or more have the same moral vision as the left. So that they can't construct an ideal out of the altruistic morality that they hold.
What we need today, what I call the new intellectual, would be any man or woman who is willing to think. Meaning, any man or woman who knows that man's life must be guided by reason, by the intellect, not by feelings, wishes, whims, or mystic revelations. any man or woman who values his life and who does not want to give in to today's cult of despair, cynicism, and impotence, and does not intend to give up the world to the dark ages and to the rule of the collectivist brutes.
All right, before we go on, reminder, please like the show. We've got 163 live listeners right now, 30 likes. That should be at least 100. I figure at least 100 of you actually like the show. Maybe there are like 60 of the Matthews out there who hate it. But at least the people who are liking it, you know, I want to see a thumbs up. There you go. Start liking it. I want to see that go to 100. All it takes is a click of a thing, whether you're looking at this. And you know, the likes matter. It's not an issue of my ego. It's an issue of the algorithm. The more you like something, the more the algorithm likes it. So, you know, and if you don't like the show, give it a thumbs down. Let's see your actual views being reflected in the likes. But if you like it, don't just sit there. Help get the show promoted. Of course, you should also share. And you can support the show at yaronbrookshow.com/support or on Patreon or Subscribestar or Locals. And show your support for all for the work, for the value hopefully you're receiving from this. And of course, don't forget, if you're not a subscriber, even if you just come here to troll, or even if you're here like Matthew to defend Marx, then you should subscribe, because that way you'll know when to show up. You'll know what shows are on, when they're on. You'll get notified, right? So, yes, like, share, subscribe, support. Like, share, subscribe, support. There you go. Easy. Do one or all of those, please.